I wrote this music, I wrote these songs to accompany a play. A play about my hometown, which is a shipyard town in the north of England. When I think of the environment I was raised in, these streets and this ship, such a huge part of our identity, part of who we were. And I'm fiercely proud of it.
It's all there on my Gospels, my Magdalene girl comes to pay her respects. But her mind is a whirl when she finds the tomb empty. Stone had been rolled, not a sign of a corpse. In the dark and the cold, when she reaches the door, sees an unholy sight. There's this solitary figure in a halo of light. He just carries on floating past Calvary Hill. In an almighty hurry, aye, but she might catch him still. Tell me, where are you going, Lord, and why in such haste? Now don't hinder me, woman, I've no time to waste. For they're launching a boat on the morrow at noon, and I have to be there before daybreak. Oh, I cannot be missing. The lads will expect me. Why else would the good Lord himself resurrect me? For nothing will stop me. I have to prevail through the teeth of this tempest, in the mouth of a gale. May the angels protect me if all else should fail. When the last ship sails, oh, the roar of the chains and the cracking of timbers, the noise at the end of the world in your ears, as a mountain of steel makes its way to the sea, and the last ship sails. It's a strange kind of beauty, it's cold and austere, and whatever it was that you've done to be here, it's the sum of your hopes, your despairs and your fears, when the last ship sails. Oh, the first to arrive saw these signs in the east, like that strange moving finger at Balthazar's feast, where they asked the advice of some wandering priest, and the sad ghosts of men whom they thought long deceased, and whatever got said, they'd be counted at least. When the last ship sails, oh, the roar of the chains and the cracking of timbers, the noise at the end of the world in your ears, as a mountain of steel makes its way to the sea, and the last ship sails. And whatever you promised, whatever you've done, and whatever the station in life you become, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and whatever the weave of this life that you've spun, on the earth or in heaven or under the sun, when the last ship sails. Oh, the roar of the chains and the cracking of timbers, the noise at the end of the world in your ears, as a mountain of steel makes its way to the sea, and the last ship.
Welcome, everybody. I'm delighted to be here because I'm presenting some brand new songs for the first time in almost a decade. All of these songs you'll hear tonight, or most of them anyway, have been inspired by the writing of a play. Now, you're not going to see the play tonight, although one of our leading men is right here behind me, Mr. Jimmy Nair. you're going to hear, what you're going to hear is the raw material from which this play is being carved or constructed or pieced together. That's not a collage, it's the picture of my street, the street I was born and raised in. And when I was old enough to walk out the front door, I'd turn south towards the river, and that's what I'd see, this mighty ship at the end of the street, blotting out the sky and the sun for most of the year. It was quite a sight, but it was a surreal industrial landscape. And every morning I'd watch thousands of men walk to work down that hill to work on the ships. I'd watch them come back at night. I wondered if that was my destiny. I didn't want it. I was frightened of the shipyard. It was noisy and dangerous. Those men, though, were tough and proud. They worked in terrible conditions, but were fiercely proud of the ships they built. They built the largest ships ever constructed on planet Earth, right at the end of my street. So this play is about my community, the community I come from. And this next song, which is probably the first I wrote in this series, some of that community present themselves. They talk about who they are, what they do, their hopes, their passions, their fears for the future. Mr. Nail, would you take the floor?
Yes.
Oh, my name is Jackie White, and I'm the foreman of the yard. And you don't mess with Jackie on this quayside. Why, I'm as hard as iron plate. We'll be tied to if you're late, when we have to push the boat out on a spring tide. Now you could die and hope for heaven, but you'd need to work your shift, and I'd expect yous all to back me to the hilt. And if St. Peter at his gate were to ask you why you're late, why, you'd tell him that you had to get a ship built. We've built battleships and cruisers for Her Majesty, the Queen, supertankers for Onassis and all the classes in between. We've built the greatest shipping tonnage that the world has ever seen. But the only life we've known is in the shipyard. Come on, boys.
Steer the stockyard, I am the soul, the conjurer of the ship where I used to be a whore.
And I don't know what we'll do if the yard gets sold. For the only life we've known is in the shipyard. Aye. All the platers and the welders and the boiler-making crews, when they see that beggar finished on the slipway, oh, all the hardships soon forgot, and we'll cheer as like as not. And the bands will wave their union jacks all day. Why, it's a patriotic scene. All that's missing is the Queen, but she said she couldn't make it of a Tuesday. Then something wells up here inside, and you could take it in your stride, but you wonder if you'll see another payday. For there's a mixture of emotions, hatred, gratitude and pride, and you hate yourself for crying, but it's difficult to hide. For there's a sadness in the launching, you worry what's ahead, and that worry never leaves you, it keeps on nagging in your head. So you pray to God for orders, but you'll worry till you're dead. Until they bury your remains in the blacksmith's shed, and the only life you've known is in the shipyard. Come on!
Steer the stockyard, I am the soul, we'll conjure up a ship where I used to be a whore.
And I don't know what we'll do if the yard gets sold, for the only life we've known is in the shipyard. I am the shipyard.
My name is Tommy Thompson, I'm shop steward for the Union. My dream is proletarian revolution.
Come on, Tom.
Comrades, brothers, fellow travelers and others, class struggle is the means of dialectic evolution. Das Kapital's me Bible, and the ruling class are liable. And Karl Marx and Engels, it's entirely justifiable if the workers' revolution here is ever to be viable. Oh, we become the rightful owners of the shipyard. So it's a one-day stoppage, or an overtime ban, or a work to rule for the five-year plan. Till the means of production is safely in our hands, and we become the rightful owners of the shipyard. I'm not saying it won't be hard if the boss answers me cards and they try to close us down like other shipyards. And if industrial action only helps the competition, as I've heard the bosses bleating from their usual position, and I stand accused of anarchy, disruption and sedition. Why, you'll never knock us down, you reactionary clowns, when it's time for occupation of the shipyard.
That's been blackening your tongue. I could give you some aspirin while you're coughing up your lung. But it's all you'll ever get here in this shipyard.
Adrian Sanderson,
just put me out on. Be patient with me.
You're on, kid.
Oh, my name is Adrian Sanderson, and riveting's my trade. But it's intellectual discourse I'm known better for. I may forego English grammar when I'm injured with a hammer, but I've a preference for the deference of a metaphor. I've read the Odyssey by Homer, and the Iliad as well. I've read Tacitus and Pliny.
Aye, and the Scarlet Pimpernel.
I spent a night shift down with Dante on his journey into hell. And that's what we'll all be facing if this yard's put up to sell. For the only life we've known is in the shipyard. Shall I go on?
Go on.
Now, what about those Trojan Wars and all the troubles that they caused when they sailed off on that summer's afternoon?
Yes, but because the ship they had was crap and they'd lost their bloody map when they tried to get themselves back to the tomb.
Listen, there's a lesson in these tales, although it happened ages past. Just like Spartacus, that film by Stanley Kubrick's. First it's tragedy, then farce, and they'll kick you up the arse when you tempt the gods with arrogance and hubris. Well, it's obvious I'm gifted with the rhyming and the meter, and hereabouts I'm thought of highly as a bard.
As a bard.
And if I wasn't shooting rivets, I'd be famous in me time. All those literary circles I could dazzle with me rhyme. I've never lacked ambition. You could say it was a crime. For rivets may be riveting, but sonnets are sublime. And the only life we've known is in the shipyard. Come on, lads.
Steel in the stockyard, iron in the soul. We'll conjure up a ship where there used to be a hole.
But we don't know what we'll do if this yard gets sold. For the only life we've known is in the shipyard. Oh, here he comes, Davy Harrison, the town drunk. All right, Davy.
Davy Harrison, I like a drink or two. You can ask me where it started and I haven't got a clue. I'm never ever miserable, I'm never ever blue, and I'll still be up tomorrow for the shipyards. I drink myself into a stupor and I wake up with two heads, and then the missus starts complaining about all me drunken deeds. Like when I got the train to Sunderland but found myself in Leeds. And I had to get up early for the shipyards. You know, I once gave up the drinking. It was 1963. Well, it seems as if sobriety was not the thing for me. It was the worst 3 hours I ever hoped to save.
Steel in the stockyard, iron in the soul. We'll conjure up a ship where there used to be a hole.
And the ship sets sail and the tale gets told. And the only life we've known is in the shipyard.
Steel in the stockyard, iron in the soul. We'll get the master fish and we'll end up on the door.
And we don't know what we'll do if the yard gets sold. The only life we've ever known is in the shipyard. So without giving too much of the play away, because I want you to come and see it eventually, it does have a love story, and our leading man is a man called Gideon. He's been away from this town for 14 years. He went away to sea, He left under a bit of a cloud. He doesn't like the place, but he's back because his dad's died, and he needs to sort some things out. But there's also some other ghosts he needs to lay, some unfinished business. This is Gideon's song. I've come home for a reason, but that reason escapes me now. The engine ceased and a wind from the east cleared a fog off the starboard bow. Well, here's the mouth of the river that spawned me. I feel like a stranger here. How long has it been? Well, I haven't been seen in these parts for 14 years. Yes, these are the streets where I once played, where some debt of the soul was left unpaid. And the place the old man's bones are laid. Coming home's not easy. I wonder if she still lives around here. That girl I've been missing these 14 years. She's probably married with kids of her own by now. Sunrise disguised in the mist this morning. It's 8 a.m. The seagull shouts a sail as a warning. This sky, this bend in the river, slows down and delivers me. The tide rolls back and all my memories fade to black. And yet I'm back. This town is a strange magnetic pole, like a homing signal in your skull. And you sail by the stars of the hemisphere, wondering how in the hell did you end up here. It's like an underground river or a hidden stream that flows through your head and haunts your dreams. And you stuff those dreams in this canvas sack, and there's nothing around here but the wide world lacks. I lie on the deck and I'd stare at the turning of the stars. Those constellations hanging up there from the cables and the rigging. I'd wonder if she saw the same or managed to recall my name. Why would she ever think of me? Some boy she loved who fled to sea. And why waste time debating whether she'd be waiting for the likes of me? So you drift into port where the scum of the seas, to the dance halls and the brothels where you took your ease. And the ship's left the dock, but you're half past caring. You haven't got a clue whose bed you're sharing. And your head's like a hammer on a bulkhead door. And it feels like somebody might have broken your jaw. And there's bloodstains and glass all over the floor. And you swear to God you're drinking no more. And yet in truth, it's too late to find her. Too late to remind her at some garden gate, where a servant tells me I should wait. Perhaps a door slammed in my face. My head must be in outer space. And yet, before the sun has set, before the sea, there may be something else that's waiting for the likes of me. Sunrise turning. The fishing boat set out upon the sea. I watch till they sail out of sight. The winter follows soon. I watch them drawn into the night beneath the August moon. And no one knows I come here. Some things I don't share. I can't explain the reasons why it moves me close to tears. Or something in the season's change will find me wandering here. And in my public moments, I hear the things I say, but they're not me. Perhaps I'll know before I die. Admit that there's a reason why I count the boats returning to the sea. I count the boats returning to the sea. Drop the mask that I've been forced to wear. But no one knows this secret me, where, albeit unconsciously, I count the boats returning from the sea. I count the boats returning from the sea. Shipyard will close with terrible results for this community. The men who had such pride and such dignity, a sense of self, will be robbed of that, robbed of their work, their jobs. A parish priest decides he needs to do something about his community, his parish. He has this wacky, quixotic, even Homeric idea. He wants the men to occupy their shipyard and build a ship for themselves. Eventually he convinces them because they realize they have nothing else. And in my dialect, they would say, what have we got? We've got naught else. And this is their song.
God, people give ear to me story. Pay attention and none of your lip. For I brought you five lies and that daddy. Intend and to build us a ship. While send us war habitation. It's the place we was all born and bred. And as they finalize in the nation, and none are more gallantly led. Soaring the commotion and the clamor in the welding of the steel. Oh, what have we got?
But the mists upon the river. And what have we got?
But that noise inside the hole.
What have we got?
But the arse end of the weather, where we work in horizontal rain and shiver in the cold.
What have we got?
What have we got?
What have we got?
What have we got?
We got notes.
We got no else.
Hey, what have we got?
What have we got?
What have we got?
What have we got?
We got notes.
We got no else.
What have we got?
But the singing in the keyboards. And what have we got?
But the ringing in your ears.
What have we got?
But the telling of the fables and the ghosts of all the ships that we've been building donkey's ears. What have we got?
What have we got?
What have we got?
What have we got?
We got notes.
We got no else.
Hey, what have we got?
What have we got?
What have we got?
What have we got?
We got notes.
We got no else.
You're standing for your tea break. You're up to here in shite. You're dying for a cigarette. You're desperate for a light. And then the gaffer pulls along with his job sheet and he reads, ah, tea break's over, gentlemen. Now get back on your heat.
Hey, what does it say in the papers?
What does it say on the news?
Oh, they said we've all gone bloody daft.
Oh, well, what have we got to lose?
What would I get for murder?
What would I get for life?
What would I get for a capital crime?
What'll I tell me wife?
What do you get for your politics?
What do you get for your vote?
What do you got at the end of the day? You're gonna die of something. It's written in your face.
You might as well die next Tuesday and won't be tight, you're late. Come on.
What do you got?
All you men, what's been neighbor? What do you got?
For straining in your neck.
What do you got?
When you're laid out on a table and the snapping of a cable when the rigging hits the deck. What do you got?
But the loyalty of brothers.
And what do you got? But the punching of the clock.
What do you got?
You reactionary clowns. Why, you'll never knock us down, cause we're the union of the gods.
What do we got?
What do we got?
What do we got?
We got nout.
We got nout else.
Hey, what do we got?
What do we got?
What do you got?
What do we got?
We got nout.
We got nout else.
You know, I didn't enter the musical theatre blithely, thinking it would be easy. It's not. The landscape is strewn with bleached corpses on either side. What I hadn't realised is just how precise and exacting a medium it is, you know. I had a fantastic team of collaborators. My first collaborator was Brian Yorkie, prize-winning, Pulitzer-winning... a fantastic director, Joe Mantello. And another prize-winning writer, John Logan. And occasionally they would tell me that a song I'd written wasn't quite right. Now, this is novel for me. But, you know, it's hard for me as my finest couplets are being thrown in the bin and I'm spluttering my flimsy protests. But every song in a musical fights for its life. Every character fights for its life. Every verse in every song fights for its life. Every line, every word is scrutinized with an intensity that's unusual. The next two songs are a case in point. I envisaged an older character called Arthur, who was about my age, who falls in love with a much younger woman. It's a common thing. This song is called Practical Arrangement, and it goes like this. Am I asking for the moon? Is it really so implausible that you and I could soon come to some kind of arrangement? I'm not asking for the moon. I've always been a realist. When it's really nothing more than a simple rearrangement. With one roof above our heads, a warm house to return to, we could start with separate beds. I could sleep alone or learn to. I'm not suggesting that we'd find some earthly paradise forever. I mean, how often does that happen now? The answer's probably never. But if we came to an arrangement, a practical arrangement, then you could learn to love me, given time.
Well, I like my independence. I get by, I'm not greedy. Do you see yourself as Galahad? Do I really look that needy? I brought a child up on my own. It takes me all my strength to face him. The father often left me, and I'm not desperate to replace him. Tell me, what kind of catch is a struggling single mother? I respect you and I like you, but I won't accept another empty promise when some gray and stormy rain cloud hangs above me. When I've heard it all 100 times from a man who said he loved me. But if we came to an arrangement, a practical arrangement, then perhaps I'd learn to love you, given time.
I'm not promising the moon. I'm not promising a rainbow. Just a practical solution to a solitary life. I'd be a father to your boy, a shoulder you could lean on. How bad could it be to be my wife? With one roof above our heads, a warm house to return to, you wouldn't have to cook for me, you wouldn't have to learn to. I'm not suggesting that we'd find some earthly paradise forever. I've no intention of deceiving you, you're far too clever. But if we come to an arrangement, a practical arrangement, then perhaps you'd learn to love me, given time. It may not be the romance that you had in mind, but you could learn to love me, given time. So that song was in the play for a while, and then one Monday morning I turned up for work, and my dramatic collaborators were sitting there at a table. It looked like an intervention was about to take place. I said, "What's up?" They said, "Arthur." "What about him?" "Practical arrangement." "Yes?" "Can't be in the play." I said, "Oh, come on, that's a great, I mean, you know." And I was really thinking, you know, Arthur is me. He's my age. You know, this is me. I said, "Well, why? What's the reason?" I said, "Well, as soon as he opens his mouth, he's clearly lost the girl. He's not going to get this girl. We need the rival to Gideon to be viable, to be young, to be virile." So I know. And it took me a good month of struggling with this issue. And then one day I woke up and said, "You know, you put yourself in the way. Get out of the way. Write a song for this character, this young, virile character. Even though you don't like him, write a song for him." So I came up with this. "There's a house on the hill that's come up for sale. It's a place I've known since I was a lad. and it needs a lick of paint and a hammer and a nail, but it's part of a boyhood dream I've always had. I'd climb up the hill with the evening news I'd been sent from the town to deliver, and I'd stand in the porch and gaze at the views till my eyes were bruised by the sunset's glow on the river. I'd imagine a girl who would share my life, as dreamers will tend to do, and the face I always conjured up was no one else but you. Another theme in our play is the perennial struggle between fathers and sons, something I know a little bit about. You know, sometimes a father will not appreciate the scope of a son's ambition, and a son will not realize that a father cares for him when he thinks he's just been controlled. In my community, there's a phrase called dead man's boots. Dead man's boots really indicates how difficult it is to get a job. You'd only get a job if someone died, so they call it dead man's boots. And when your father gets you a job in the shipyard and you say no, that's trouble. He said, you see these work boots in my hands? They'd probably fit you now, my son. Take them, they're a gift from me. Why don't you try them on? It would do your old man good to see you walking in these boots one day, and take your place among the men who work upon the slipway. These dead man's boots, though they're old and curled, when a fella needs a job and a place in the world, and it's time for a man to put down roots and walk to the river in his old man's boots.
He was dying, son, and asking that you do one final thing, you see. You were barely but a sapling on, you thought you were a tree. If you need a seed to prosper, you must first put down some roots. He wanted you to settle in your old man's boots. These dead man's boots know their way down the hill. They can walk there themselves and they probably will. There's a place for you there to sink your roots and take a walk down the river in your old man's boots.
I said, why in the hell would I do that? Why would I agree? When his hand was all that I'd received, as far as I remember, it's not as if he'd spoiled me with his kindness up to then, you see. I had a plan of my own and I'd quit this place when I came of age, September. These dead man's boots know the way down the hill. They can walk there themselves and they probably will. I've plenty of choices, I've plenty of the roots, and he'd never see me walking in these dead man's boots. What was it made him think I'd be happy ending up like him? But he'd hardly got two hip in his left or a broken pot to piss in. He wanted the same thing for me. Was that his final wish?
So what the hell are you gonna do, lad?
I said, anything but this. These dead man's boots roll their way down the hill. They can walk there themselves and they probably will. But they won't walk with me cause I'm off the other way. I've had it up to here, I'm gonna have my say. When all you got left is that cross on the wall, I want nothing from you, I want nothing at all. Not a pension or a pittance when your whole life is through. Get this through your head, I'm nothing like you. I'm done with all the arguments, there'll be no more disputes. And you'll die before you see me in your dead man's boots. Most of the people on the stage come from the northeast of England, and they have five brothers here from my neck of the woods. They're called the Wilson family. I actually thought I was hiring the Beach Boys, but that I was pretty soon I figured they weren't. They're going to sing a song which was a poem by Rudyard Kipling, written in 1911. Called Big Steamers, and the music was by Peter Bellamy, and this is the Wilson family.
Oh, where are you going to hold your big steamers with England's own coal up and down the salt sea?
We're going to fetch you your bread and your butter, your beef, pork and mutton, legs, apples and cheese.
And where will you fetch it from, all you big steamers? And where shall I write you when you are away?
We'll fetch it from Melbourne, Quebec and Vancouver, addresses at Hobart, Hong Kong and Bombay.
But if anything happened to all you big steamers, suppose you were wrecked up and down the salt sea,
then you'd have no coffee or bacon for breakfast, and you'd have no muffins or toast for your tea.
Then I'll pray for fine weather for all you big steamers, with little blue billows and breezes so soft.
Oh, billows and breezes, don't bother big steamers, for we're iron below and still rigging along.
Then I'll build a new lighthouse for all you big steamers, with plenty wise pilots for to pilot you through.
Oh, the channel's as bright as a ballroom already, and pilots are thicker than pilchards at loo.
Then what can I do for you, oh, you big steamers? Or what can I do for your comfort and good?
Send out your big warships to watch your big waters, that no one may stop us from bringing your food. For the bread that you eat and the biscuits you nibble, the sweets that you suck and the joints that you cough, they are brought to you daily by all those big steamers. And if anyone hinders our coming, you will stop.
That's the Wilson family.
This next song concerns the mild hazing that would go on when an apprentice had his first day at the shipyard. You would be sent for some spurious, non-existent item like a left-handed screwdriver, a glass hammer, or you might be sent for a long wait. In this case, our hapless apprentice is going to be played by Jimmy. He does hapless very well, don't he? Yeah. He's going to be sent for a brace, that's two, a brace of skyhooks, presumably something you hook onto the sky. Is going to be sent for a packet of nail holes, and finally, two cans of tartan paint. Thank you. Oh, and I'm going to make my debut on the spoons in New York City. Almost forgot.
In the shipyards, the gaffer says to me, I want you to go to the store, lad, and get a few things, do you see? Now here's a list, can you read, lad? Can you read it back to me? And me and the boys will listen while we're having our morning tea. Oh, now reading was me pride. When I left school at 14, there wouldn't be a problem here. I'd show them I was keen. But when I starts to reading, they just couldn't hold their mirth, splitting their sides and spluttering like they was giving birth. First off, a brace of skyhooks and a packet of nail holes neat, and then three cans of tartan paint, and that's me task complete. The gaffer swipes me on the head and sends me on me way. He says,
don't come back empty-handed, lad, I'll have to dock your pay.
So he gets to the store nervous, and the quartermaster's there. He pulls the list out of his pocket, and he starts to read all square. Well, he hadn't barely finished when the storeman's face turns red. He gives him such an evil look, he thought he'd soon be dead.
First off, a brace of skyhooks and a packet of nail holes deep, and then three cans of tartan paint, and that's me task complete. The storeman sets me on the heat and sends me on me way.
Well, then a kick in the arse for good measure, and such was my first day.
Says to me,
how was it, son? How was your day? Sit down and have some tea.
I told her of the list I'd read and the trouble I was in. I couldn't go back tomorrow, else they'd gather me skinned.
First off, a brace of skyhooks and a packet of nail holes.
And then three cans of tartan beer, and that's me task complete. The mother swakes me on me heat and sends me on me way.
What are they kicking the arse for me effort?
And such was my first day. First off, a brace of sky hoops and a pack of the devil's feet. And then three cans of tartan beer, and that's me task complete. The mother swakes me on me heat and sends me on me way.
What are they kicking the arse for me effort?
So, I have a very good friend that I've known for many years, Mr. Billy Connolly, the actor and comedian. Before he was a famous actor and a comedian, he worked in the shipyards as a welder in Glasgow, in Scotland, and he told me some stuff about welders that I found very amusing. He said, all welders are crazy. They're crazy because of the welding fumes that they have to ingest for 8-hour shifts. Also, they're all practical jokers. You should never let a welder get behind you, or he'll weld your heels, the steel toe caps, to the deck and you'll fall over. The other thing about welders is that all of them sing, all of them, because in the welder's helmet, there's a natural echo chamber. So they all think they're Elvis Presley. They sing all day. So this idea really tickled me, and I wrote this next song. It's called Jock, the Singing Welder. Any shipyard man can sing when he works upon the hull, amongst the noise and the clamour that he all but disregards. So he sings to himself, and no one pays him any mind. He's just another crazy welder in the shipyards. But inside this welder's helmet, if you'll let me demonstrate, when the mask is in position and the fumes accumulate, there's the finest echo chamber with a sound that can't be beat, where I'm a king of rock and roll and the world is at me feet. And it may not sound like much to all them jokers on the squad, but inside of here I'm singing with the voice of fucking God. I'm Jock, the singing welder, heavy metal, rock and roll, jazz, blues, roots, reggae, country, rockabilly, soul. When I'm singing, well, you best lock up your daughters and your mothers. I'm Gene Vincent, Eddie Cochran, I'm the missing every brother. I'm Jock, the singing welder, I'm heading for the heights. I'm Jock, the singing welder, I'm a circling lights. Well, I'm more than just a welder, and I'm telling you my name. And one day you'll see it blazing in the Rock and Hall of Fame. I got these songs in my head, I got this dancing in my bones. I'm Roy Orbison, Elvis Presley, I'm Tom fucking Jones. I'm Jock, the singing welder, I'm heading for the heights. I'm Jock, the singing welder, and the settling lights. Yeah, yeah, yeah. There was a prehistoric welder who figured out what it was worth. They call it holy metallurgy, and I want it to be clear that no man puts the sun to what I joined together here. Jock, the singing welder in the belly of a ship. I got my shaky leg, I got my quivering lip. I'm Jock, the singing welder, I just haven't got a choice, cause I'm singing all day at the top of my voice. I'm Jock, the singing welder, around the settling lights. There's an empty throne waiting every Saturday night. There'll be no more mistaking where I set my sights, cause I ain't no pretender, cause it's mine by rights. I'm Jock, the singing welder, around the settling light. Jock, the singing welder, around the settling light. Jock, the singing welder, and the settling light. Jock, the
was singing well back in the oxy is settled in late.
So here's a plot spoiler alert. You can close your ears if you want. Our beloved Father O'Brien, whose idea this shipbuilding was, is not going to make it through the second act. He's been diagnosed with a terrible disease. And first, this scene was just a dramatic scene. There was no singing in it. And then our esteemed producer came to me one day and said, "String, you've got to musicalize that scene." Now, I'd never heard that verb before, but I knew what he meant. And luckily, already in the text, there was a metaphor which I thought I could use. The song is called So to Speak. Thank you. They're seriously saying it's prolonging me life if I'll only submit to this surgical knife. But what are the odds on a month or a week when the betting shop's closing its doors, so to speak? When you're tied to a pump and a breathing machine with their x-rays and probes and their monitor screens, and they'll wake you up hungry saying, "How do you feel?" And then you're stuffed full of pills or a barium meal. Prolonging me life, now that's some kind of joke. I'd be laughing me head off and I'd probably choke. The spirit's still willing, but the rest of me's weak. Now the bets are all off and the prospects look bleak. When you're laid like a piece of old meat on the slab, and they'll cut and they'll slice and they'll poke and they'll jab, and they'll grill you and burn you, and they'll wish you good health with their radium, chemo, and God knows what else. Well, you can't fault the science, though the logic is weak. Is it really an eternal life we should seek? That ship has sailed, that ship has sailed, that ship has already sailed, so to speak. Our mission is more than a struggle for breath, for a few extra rounds and a fight to the death. When our mission is love and compassion and grace, is that a test of endurance or a marathon race? For love is the saber and love is the shield. Love is the only true power we wield. And eternal love is all you should seek. And that ship will be ready to sail, so to speak.
The ship of my heart doesn't know what it seeks. And the water's way over my head, so to speak.
So make your decision, Meg, hold to it fast. Keep your hand on the tiller, tie yourself to the mast. For this sea of emotions, no place for the meek. When it's only eternity's love you should seek. When that ship sails and the course has been set, and the wind's in the offing and the sails have been let, and the hatches are full and the hull doesn't leak, that ship will be ready to sail, so to speak. Tired and fading and losing the light, and I've nowhere to tell if it's day or it's night.
Follow your heart, it's the harbor you seek.
Oh, this ship is ready to sail. This ship is ready to sail. This ship is ready to sail. So to speak.
Mm-hmm.
respect on this deck for the dear departed. Gather yous round, let's be bound by the work we started. Save all your strength for the length of the task before us. Think on that ship on the slipway, they can't ignore us. It's what he would have wanted, he'll not be disappointed. Each of us well appointed, we've all but been anointed. Such was our occupation, this means of our salvation. We'll make a robot of our dreams and hopes and tribulation. We'll weave these strands together, we'll splice our rope and tether. And though we won't know whether it's fair or stormy weather, we'll quit this key and we'll cast this net of souls upon the sea.
Are you with me?
Pick up your tools, we're not fools to be treated lightly. We'll weld our souls to the bulkhead,
secure them tightly.
We'll use the skills and the crafts that our fathers taught us. We'll work with pride, not as slaves. No one ever bought us. We'll weave a net of our dreams and our hopes between us. We'll be the envy of that sorry bunch who wish they'd been us. We'll form a web of steel, a structure that will not be broken. We'll be the heroes of the day whenever tales are spoken.
And as the dance gets faster, we'll build a double master. No vessel will outlast her, no other ship gets past her. We'll quit this key and we'll cast this net of souls upon the sea.
Strike the floor with your feet, all your lads and lasses. And if you're too old to dance, you can raise your glasses. Just come on in, take a spin in your dreams you've held up.
What are you, man or a mouse?
Our shipyard welder. Shipmen's getting out for waiting, so why are you hesitating? Ships don't get built debating, all on just contemplating. Wear out your old shoe leather, wear it. Together, we'll pull the blazing feather in fair or clement weather. Each one of us connected, our trades and skills respected, always to be expected. We will not be deflected. We'll quit this key and we'll cast this net of souls upon the sea. Just don't be left on the shores of regretful glances. We may not drive Rolls Royces, we're hardly spoiled for choices. If we're to pay invoices, we'll need to raise our voices. Our strength is in communion, this boilermaker's union, the shipwright welder's guild, with every working station fair. These bonds will splice together, we'll face all kinds of weather. Consider it all together, and sail in hell for leather. We'll quit this key and we'll cast this net of souls upon the sea.
Where will you be when we cast this net of souls upon the sea?
Show some respect on this deck for the dear departed. Let's be bound by the work
upon the sea.
Thank you.
none of us can see. And it flows through winding tunnels on its way to a tidal sea. And across that sea is an island, a paradise we are told, where the joys of life are forgotten and they call it the island of souls. For only soul can go there, the soul that's been set free from the confines of our working life to find eternity.
Your dad had a cage for his pigeons, and they say that's where he kept his soul. And when he watched them fly, he would see himself. At least that's how it was told.
But his soul was still trapped in the cage, so while the birds he saw to the sky, he couldn't find his own way out. At least not till the day he died. Oh, man builds a cage with the tools he is given. His casket is sealed where the river has gone. All the days in between he's just making a living. Well, he takes to his bed and he lays down his head and he's passed down his tools to his son.
The words he'd be easier speaking the language of birds, for to speak of emotion, oh, it just wasn't done. It was him that was trapped in the soul cage, son. It was him that was trapped in the soul cage.
Oh, man builds a cage with the tools he is given. His casket is sealed where the river has gone. All the days in between he's just making a living, till he takes to his bed and he lays down his head and he's passed on his tools to his son. And the ship's left the key, only now is he free and the days of his labor are done. Oh, man builds a cage with the tools he's given, his casket is sealed where the river has gone. All the days in between he's just making a living, till he takes to his bed and he lays down his head and he's passed down his tools to his son. Before we leave you tonight, then, we have one more song, but first of all, I want to tell you a little story. You know, in my hometown, we never saw any celebrities. I'm very short on celebrities in my town. Except when they would launch a big ship they would invite a member of the royal family to come to our town to throw some champagne at the bow, and the ship would go into the river. So one Saturday, my mother dresses me up in my Sunday best, which I hate, and she gives me a little British flag, the Union Jack, and the whole street's out there, and everybody's really excited, even the communists are excited, because the Queen Mother is coming. So we're all stood there, and then suddenly at the top of the hill, there's some motorcycle outriders, police, and then this gigantic Rolls Royce moving very slowly in a stately fashion down the street. Now, to explain to you Americans what the royal family means to the British. It wasn't that long ago that children with diseases like scrofula were held up to touch the hem of the monarch's garment to cure them, right? It's true. So there I am, stood there, and the car's moving past me, and I wave my little flag, and the Queen Mother waves back. She smiles at me, and I smile, and I wave my... She sees me. She picks me out of all of the crowd. And, well, I wasn't cured of anything. That was the opposite. I was infected with something. I was infected with this idea that I don't want to be on the street. I don't want to end up in that shipyard. I want to be in that car. And so I'm here. Anyway, appropriately, this next song begins in Buckingham Palace. You ready?
Ready.
And you, Jackie White, shall I pass you this chalice? Is there something afoot down at Buckingham Palace?
Well, the footmen are frantic in their indignation, for it seems the Queen's took a taxi herself to the station, where the porters, surprised by a lack of royal baggage, bustle her and three corgis to the rear of the carriage. For the train it is crammed with all Europe's nobility, none of them famed for their compatibility. There's a fight over seats, I beg pardon, Your Grace, but you'll find that one's mine, so get back in your place. Ah, but where are they going? The porters debate. Why, they're going to Newcastle, and they daresn't be late, for they're launching aboard on the Tyne at high tide. And they've come from all over, from far and from wide. Oh, there's the old Dalai Lama and the Pond of Rome, every palace in Europe, and there's no bugger home. Here's the Duchess of Cornwall and the loyal Prince of Wales, looking crushed and uncomfortable in his top hat and tails. And they haven't got tickets. Oh, but it's just a detour. There was no time to purchase, and one has to prevail. Or we'll get to the shipyard, or we'll end up in jail. And the last ship sails, all the roar of the chains and the cracking of timbers, the noise like the end of the world in your ears, as a mountain of steel makes its way to the sea. And the last ship sails. It's a strange kind of beauty, it's cold and austere, and whatever it was that you've done to be here, it's the sum of your hopes, your despairs and your fears, when the last ship sailed. Oh, the first to arrive saw these signs in the east, like that strange moving finger at Balthazar's feast, where they asked the advice of some wandering priest, and the sad ghosts of men whom they thought long deceased, and whatever got sad, they'd be counted at least. When the last ship sails, oh, the roar of the trains and the cracking of timbers, the noise at the end of the world in your ears,
mountain of steel makes its way to the sea, and the last ship sails. And whatever you promised, whatever you've done, and whatever the station in life you become, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and whatever the weave of this life that you've spun, on the earth or in heaven, when the last ship sails, oh, the roar of the chains and the cracking of timbers, the noise at the end of the world in your ears, as a mountain of steel makes its way to the sea, and the last ship
I don't think anything you do can get away from who you are. Why would it? Why would you want it to? I'm proud of my story. I think it's a good story. It's not finished yet. But I'm proud of who I am. I'm proud of where I come from. That's a simple, abiding emotion in me, is gratitude. I'm grateful.
Why fear hell when you're already there? Three young Irish women face years of abuse as inmates of the Magdalene Sisters. Next.